So when I think about the living building challenge, and I explain it to people, I have them think about the difference between a building on one hand and a living organism on the other. So imagine, if you will, a flower. And so imagine buildings that get all their energy from the sun. Imagine buildings that work within their watershed completely. They get the rain for all their water needs. They don't bring in a pipeline of water from, you know, dozens of miles away and then create waste that is exported. They treat their waste on site and they produce soil. This is the idea behind the Living Building Challenge, is can we devise architecture that is as elegant and efficient as the natural systems that have worked for millions of years on this planet? How do we do that?
We need to move to a world of living buildings and living communities as fast as humanly possible. We need to skip to that point, right? We need to use life's principles as the measurement for our success in our environment, not square feet.
Our job is to design green buildings. It's not our job. We as a species have lost our way. What we're doing is creating habitat for our species within a larger network of species that is life. And that's our mission. To think that we're designing things is a failure of our industry.
You can't just take a conventional approach and add efficiency to it. You actually have to rethink about your own interaction with the building, your own usage patterns and everything. And when you do this, you really do need to rethink the whole design process. It's one of the powerful things about Living Building Challenge.
And we really believe that we need to transform the built environment to do three things, which you'll hear us say a lot. We want communities that are socially just, culturally rich, and ecologically restorative. So the Living Building Challenge is broken into several different categories, and we call these categories petals. And so the first petal is place. And so there's a whole bunch of criteria around how you build in a particular place and the impact that you have. And then there's energy. So we look at where the energy is from, and is it renewable, for example? Is there a downstream or upstream impacts? And then the third one is water. In a similar fashion, we're making sure that we're not having the kind of impact with our water systems that industrial water systems have, that is more attuned to a particular place. Then there's materials. So we are concerned about where materials are from and what they're made of and what their legacy is in terms of upstream and downstream impacts to communities. Are they toxic? Do they cause habitat disruptions? So we look very carefully at materials. And then we look at other issues that impact people. So we have a petal for equity, we have a petal for health, and we have a petal for beauty and how it impacts people and their world. And so all those categories together comprise the Living Building Challenge, which is the world's most stringent green building system.
We know this, but we don't talk about it really enough. We're losing every major battle, whether it's climate, whether it's deforestation, habitat loss, the health of our oceans, right? We're losing every single battle.
Just like it is with living buildings, is that's what people who don't understand what this movement is about to think, well, what's the big deal of a few buildings? That it's not about the few buildings, it's about the change in the conversation.
And you can't go back once you realize that this is the way you should do things. So once you're doing a living building project, it makes you realize that the way you're doing it before wasn't the way you should be doing it, and it changes how you approach a project.
This idea of living buildings is not just a utopian idea, it's not fiction, it's happening now. We're in a living building right now in my house, and we're building these living buildings all over the planet in different climate systems, in different regions of the world, and they're very hopeful because they're showing that humanity, when it builds its architecture, can have the kind of impact on the planet that any other species does that helps build life. And that's what I'm interested in. How do we create conditions that are conducive to life?